Joel Brenner, thank you for talking with us.
Pleasure.
So is when it comes to Edward Snowden's revelations and disclosures, what do you make of those? Is the NSA overreaching, or is it doing what it's supposed to do?
Well, I don't think you can reasonably say NSA is overreaching. You could ask whether the Congress was right when it passed Section 215 of the Patriot Act. You could ask whether the FISA court was right when it interpreted the act in a way that let NSA collect all the metadata that it's been collecting. But it's really important to understand that NSA hasn't done anything, as I understand it and from all I know, that goes one inch beyond what it's been authorized to do by a court.
How can you be confident of that?
Oh, I'm not privy any longer to what goes on inside of Fort Meade at the agency. But I know how the place works. And I know that based on the revelations that we know that have come out, nothing it has done has violated any of those orders. And that's an important thing to focus on, because the agency, you know, you could complain about that you don't like the fact that this information is being collected, but it's not NSA that decided to collect it.
So tell us, how extensive is the NSA's collection of data on American citizens, on their phone calls, on their emails, on their use of the internet?
This is, you know, the program only involves telephony metadata, not emails, not geographic location information. The idea that NSA is keeping files on Americans as a general rule just isn't true. There's no basis for believing that. The NSA is collecting the metadata, and I don't want to play that down. I don't want to suggest that that's not important. Big data and the growth of it, the uncontrollable growth of it, in the private sector as well as the government, is a huge issue in modern life, and it ought to be discussed publicly. That's a good thing. But the idea that NSA is compiling dossiers on people the way J. Edgar Hoover did in the 40s and 50s, or the way the East German police did, as some people allege, that's just not true.
Well, we've been talking to a couple of former NSA employees, and one of the allegations they make is that it's not just collecting this metadata on telephone conversations, it's recording those conversations, and it's storing them and keeping them for potential possible future use.
I think you're talking about Mr. Tice and Mr. Binney. Mr. Binney hasn't been at the agency since 2001. Mr. Tice hasn't been at the agency since 2005. They don't know what's going on inside the agency.
So is it possible that the NSA is not only collecting phone numbers and the fact that phone calls take place, but is also recording all the calls and saving the calls? Is that possible?
I have no reason to believe that's true, Judy. And I've told you that I'm not there now. I've left a couple of years ago, but I just don't think so. I've never seen any evidence to believe that it's true.
Another allegation we heard from them, from Mr. Tice, is that back as of the time before he left the NSA in the early 2000s, that there was spying going on news organizations, on Supreme Court justices, on presidential candidates, then Senator Barack Obama, on military leaders, top generals in the Army.
Mr. Tice was terminated from the agency in May 2005, as I recall. He alleged that his termination was in retaliation for having unearthed a Chinese spy at the Defense Intelligence Agency where he used to work. That issue came to me as the Inspector General of NSA at the time, and there was simply no evidence of it. And as you may know, the job that I held after that was in charge of counterintelligence policy and security, policy and strategy. We were keenly interested in unearthing spies. That was a subject that we pay a lot of attention to. There was simply no evidence of it. After that, Mr. Binney testified before the House Government Reform Subcommittee at some point. I forget the date. And he disclosed to the committee that there was a program he couldn't tell them about that might have been unconstitutional, and that the Inspector General of NSA, that would have been me, didn't have access to. Well, as the Inspector General of NSA, I had access to any program that I wanted to have access to. So I know that what he was saying wasn't true. It was simply fluff.
And you said month, Mr. Binney said this.
I meant to say Mr. Tice. Yes, I never had to deal with Mr. Binney in my job. I'm sorry, I misspoke, Mr. Tice. And last month, Mr. Tice made the allegations you've just indicated, having to do with the period before 2005, 8 years ago. They're just coming out now. I wonder why. The farther he gets from the period when he could have known what he was talking about, the more fanciful his allegations have become.
Let me ask you about another point they make, and that is that even if you believe that what is being done now is the right thing to do to protect American security, to protect the interests of, security interests of the United States, there could be future governments, future leaders in this country, in our government, who could take this information and use it in a way that would abuse the civil liberties of Americans and abuse their freedom.
This is an important issue. If we're going to collect this information, we should only be doing it if the Congress of the United States is persuaded that we really are using it and need it in order to roll up terrorist plots. Now, General Alexander and the intelligence committees are persuaded of that. You and I don't have access to that information. We just don't. But the Congress does, or most of the key committees in the Congress do. And if that's true, if we're rolling up terrorist plots because of that information, I don't believe any president or any Congress would responsibly deny that authority. The question then becomes, how do we surround that authority with the kind of really severe controls to make sure that that kind of abuse doesn't take place? Because it is a danger. We're right in a democracy to distrust power and secrecy. This is a powerful organization. Well, I don't think the public understands that in the United States, we have turned intelligence into a regulated industry in a way that none of our allies, even in Europe, have done. We have all three branches of government now involved in overseeing the activities of the NSA, the CIA, the DIA, and our other intelligence apparatus. This is an enormous achievement. Could we make it better? I think so. I think, for example, that the auditing process ought to be probably put in statute. It certainly ought to be put in regulation. And that hasn't been done. We ought to do that. I think aspects of the FISA court could be made public. There's the possibility that when the FISA court considers an interpretation of law, there ought to be counsel in there opposing the government. These are good ideas. But by and large, we've done a really good job as a country in putting a shackle on our intelligence agency. And I say again, it's the Congress that's given NSA this authority. It's a federal court that's interpreted it. It's not the agency that's off on a lark.
Joel Brenner, thank you very much.
Pleasure.